Welcome to the Libertarian Counterpoint. I'm Richard Fields. On the program today, we have John Cameron, author of Rewire and Rekill, and PLF, Pacific Legal Foundation Development Officer, Jeremy Talcott and Johanna Talcott, Pacific Legal Foundation College of Public Interest Law Attorneys, and yes, they in fact are brother and sister. Welcome to the show. We talk a lot about various issues on the on this show. One of the issues that almost, you know, comes up very frequently is the whole thing about the Second Amendment. And the Second Amendment is actually part of legal discourse in the last few years with Heller and McDonald and other legal cases. Tell me, what is the libertarian position on the Second Amendment, and you know, in so many words?
Well, I can't speak for all libertarians, but
nobody
I know
can.
It's an impossible attempt. But there is a second Amendment right to bear arms, and I think for me the most important part of that right is self-defense and the ability to defend yourself against threat of harm, against death, not only from your government but from any aggressor that may come after you. And Heller. It was such an important decision because prior to that, courts were generally treating it as a collective right, that, you know, it was for the purpose of militia to be able to defend themselves. And what Heller changed is that it recognized that that was an individual right, and at the core of that right was self-defense.
And self-defense, I always like to argue that the real reason for the Second Amendment is not to go hunting, not to do target practicing or to shoot skeet. The real purpose of the Second Amendment is to, as Thomas Jefferson said, when, you know, every once in a while blood must be shed for liberty. It's to throw off a tyrannical government if the need be. That is the ultimate purpose of the Second Amendment. I know that sounds very revolutionary today. It was very revolutionary when it was written. It was written right after a bloody revolution. Mm-hmm. That, I think, is the thing that needs to be remembered about the Second Amendment. It's not about target shooting. Mm-hmm. That being the case, is there any reason at all why the caliber or the type of arms should be limited like we do in banning machine guns?
I would say
nuclear weapons.
We go, and that's a tough one. If we go back to what liberals like to do in not neocons, but people in power who want the power to be in the hands of the government, they do this a little assumptive sale. And the assumptive sale is, well, what do you need an assault rifle to go hunting for, or to shoot birds, or to shoot a burglar? And what they do is they skip right past the fact that our founding fathers were fearful enough of tyranny that they'd recently thrown off, and knowledgeable enough to know enough about history that anyone in power who's going to seize more power, is their intent was to have people have the means to make governments fearful to attempt to put them under their boot. And so at that time, the high-tech weapon was a rifled musket. And so you could have a cannon, you could have a musket, you could have whatever. Now our police forces have tanks. So, you know, if you were left to a muzzle-loading shotgun to shoot pheasants, you wouldn't have a whole lot of chance to protect yourself when the brown shirts kicked in your front door with a tank.
So should we solve this by arming our police with muzzle loaders? I kind of like that.
Well, you know, that liberal assumptive close, or that government is good and needs more power assumptive close, always does the assumptive close, which is you don't need it for hunting, you know, and they ignore what Richard said. So our founding fathers knew that we needed whatever would make government fearful to try to put their boot on our neck. And what makes them fearful is a steel-jacketed round that will penetrate anything but ballistic armor, and if well-placed, ballistic armor. Now, do I sound like a terrorist when I say that? No, because I'm not saying go out and shoot policemen. What I'm saying is that if some thug kicks your door in without a search warrant in hand or an order from a judge or a law passed by your peers, that you have the ability to defend yourself. And we've seen on this show how government overreach increases and increases and increases. And now unelected bureaucrats who have a radical agenda are creating, in essence, laws because they have courts, mm-hmm. and they have the power to punish and the power to jail. And those are the kinds of people we need to protect ourselves from. And I think it's any law, any weapon we can get our hands on that will make them fearful to further encroach on our freedom. That's what I think.
I don't disagree, but I think that that's what makes the Second Amendment argument so unpalatable to people on the other side.
Oh, absolutely. It's a very scary thing to say.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And so what I like so much about the Heller opinion is that it really does focus on personal self-defense, that you have an inherent right to defend yourself. Mm-hmm. And
leaves the government out of it. You're defending yourself against bad guys.
At least emphasize that,
Not naming the bad guys.
You know, a tyrannical overthrow is far less, you know, immediate than me walking to the parking garage for my work at 9 o'clock at night and having to walk walking down a dark alley by myself, and that's the kind of Second Amendment right that I think should be valuable to everybody, Democrats, Republicans, Libertarians
alike. It's certainly
alike.
Certainly an easier sell.
It's an easier sell, and I think so. It's important to emphasize that as much as possible because I've had those arguments with people that. Why do you need a gun? Why do you need a gun? I think there are very good reasons that the average citizen needs a gun.
And I would take that one step further and say, I don't need to need a gun. All I simply need is to want a gun. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. it is my constitutional right to have something that I want. And it's spelled out right here in the Second Amendment. I don't have to prove to you, which is the problem with permits for concealed carry. Mm-hmm. You somehow have to prove to a local sheriff, county by county throughout the United States, that you have a need to protect yourself. I would think looking at crime statistics or any news story would prove that. Not that I need to prove it, because the Second Amendment doesn't say, prove that you need to protect yourself and I will issue you a permit to carry a weapon.
Right to bear arms.
It says you have
a right
to bear arms, period. Or as my English wife would say, full stop. There's no question mark at the end of it. There's a full stop. Mm-hmm.
One of the other unfortunate parts of modern life in these United States is the fact that the NSA, the federal government in various agencies, CIA, NSA, FBI, and a bunch of other ones that are too sacred to be named, think they have the right to listen to everything that we say on the telephone, read everything that we text or that we email, and otherwise a spy on us, probably coming right down to drones looking in our bedroom window when it comes right down to it.
Our roof with infrared.
What is the libertarian position on overreaching, overzealous desire by government to spy on its citizens?
I've been talking
John, go
too
ahead.
Much.
But you'll take that on? Okay.
I'll take it on. I'm a libertarian, and the thing about you never want to do is have two libertarians speak at any event because they'll disagree with each other. But most libertarians believe in civil liberty as well as economic liberty, hence the term libertarian. I'm a veteran, and I spent 4 years of my life in uniform. I jumped out of airplanes. I carried a machine gun, defending our Constitution. And I personally feel as if this gentleman, Edward Snowden, deserves the highest medal this country can award for letting people know that an agency designed to protect us has decided to spy on us without asking permission, without getting permission, without even thinking that they needed to get permission, and has, on top of it, shown no proof that anything they did in any way helped to fight the imaginary war that they're fighting on a non-existent threat, which is terror. So
I wouldn't say non-existent, but very minimal.
Well, I think I'm in as much danger sitting here right now being killed by a terrorist.
You're in more danger of drowning in your bathtub.
I'm certainly in more danger. I'm not a bath taker. I do go swimming, so that would do it. But I think I'm in an equal amount of danger from a meteorite strike as I am from dying by a terrorist act. Mm. And so, again, it's about assumption of power. And, you know, fine if somebody shows me a real threat and asks the representatives that I've elected for permission to pass a law to do something, then I'm not saying I'm okay with it, but I'd be better okay with it than I am with these people doing this right now. I don't remember any part of the Constitution stating that an agency whose payroll is a secret, whose purpose is a secret, whose staffing is a secret, can do whatever it wants at any time without me having any control over it. And that's what's going on there.
And I would take it a little bit, add to that people like Edward Snowden, American mm-hmm. citizen, Julian Assange, an Australian citizen, rather than being fugitives in the Soviet Union or in the Ecuadorian embassy, should be welcomed back to their home countries with open arms and given the Nobel Peace Prize, because they have done a service. Mm-hmm. They have not only defended the right to privacy, but they've also done a stupendous job of First Amendment reporting. Mm-hmm. And where are the reporters at the Washington Post and at the New York Times and at Time Magazine and the various television networks? Where are they when it comes to actually reporting? Why are we dependent upon Snowden releasing information and WikiLeaks releasing information in order to find out what our elected leaders and our would-be elected leaders are up to? That's my question.
And I certainly, I think I understand the idea of prosecuting Snowden. I think he violated laws and probably...
I'm not sure what law he violated. Yeah,
I think there's probably...
It was
probably
a World War I law, which was passed under Woodrow Wilson, who was probably the worst president that we've had up until Nixon.
But I think I do think that we as a people owe him a great debt of thanks. And I think that finding that out is... If he were prosecuted, I think we as a people should make it well known exactly how we feel about that.
I would think that in a jury trial, the Fully Informed Jury Association, the FIJA rules would apply, which is you can judge not only the facts of the case, mm-hmm. but the law in question. Mm-hmm. And the only law that I'm aware of is the, I forget the name of the law, but it's something about consorting with the enemy or something like mm-hmm. that. The law that is being cited mm-hmm. as something that he violated is a law that no American today mm-hmm. would have any truck with whatsoever. They'd say the hell with that law.
Well, let's talk for a minute about someone who is tasked with protecting Americans and defending the Constitution, Secretary of State, who chose to not even make herself aware of ways to protect what are obviously dangerous things and put them in a place where a 3-year-old, not a 3-year-old, a 12-year-old with a modicum of hacker knowledge could get at and put people at risk, whether they're doing something we'd approve of or not. Why is this person who is tasked with keeping secrets, who's laid those secrets bare, really, for anyone to watch, not being prosecuted under the same...
Well, I would say that the reason for that is because the director of the FBI, the same person who put Martha Stewart in jail for exactly the same thing, lying to the FBI, had orders from the attorney general, who had met with, on an airplane, the husband of said candidate, and the fix was in. I think it's real simple. The fix was in, and he laid out all the reasons why she should be indicted, and then said, "Well, her intention was such that I can't."
But hold on here. We have two lawyers here. We're as soon as they pass their case. Now, they've been through law school and know more about law.
Well, the other thing about Hillary Clinton is she's not that smart. She, in fact, did not pass the Washington, D.C. bar exam.
Had to take her bar in Arkansas.
Had to go to Arkansas in order to pass. So we're not talking...
And there the bar is
we're really not talking about the sharpest tack in the shed.
So back to this question. Why do we have one person who goes to prison for lying to the FBI, whereas another person who lied repeatedly? And this was on an insider trading thing, which, yes, money's involved, and yes, insider trading is illegal in the United States, but virtually nowhere else in the world, which is one of the other reasons why we find it hard to compete. What we send people to prison for here is perfectly okay in most of the stock markets around the world. It's a normal thing. If you have insider knowledge, you worked 30 years to get there, why shouldn't you use it, right? So that I would consider a small crime on the national scale compared to lying repeatedly about something which puts lives, many lives, at risk. Lied 20, 30, 40, I don't know how many times. Not just once.
I'm sure she doesn't know either.
Many times, because she can't remember.
Yeah,
can't remember.
At this point.
I'm sorry, I don't remember. I can't keep track of it. So how can that possibly not be? Stewart was sentenced to, what, 5 or 6 years and got out in a couple?
Yeah.
Well, you know, like that. So this should be a 300-year crime based on
that. Yeah, it really comes down to this idea of prosecutorial discretion. And the, you know, the hard part about it is that that can be a really good thing, because obviously there are times where you have two people who commit very similar actions, but when you look at the reasoning, it maybe makes sense not to charge someone. And
the problem with prosecutorial discretion being a good thing is that says something about the underlying laws being bad things.
It says
that the laws are way too stringent and too unnecessary, probably in most cases.
Why
should somebody do something that's illegal? Why should that not be prosecutable? It's probably because the law is bad.
I kind of let I lost my point in mid-diatribe, and I want to apologize. Here's a question I wanted to ask, that is, he said flat out, well, she didn't intend to break the law or had no knowledge that she was breaking the law, but ignorance of the law is no excuse.
I think you could find a lot of people in prison who didn't intend.
Yeah. I didn't intend to break the law. I was not aware the law existed. Why am I in prison for 20 years? So illegally, that's not a defense, is it? Ignorance of a law?
Generally, no. And especially when we have these laws that have what's called a mens rea requirement. They're just kind of nothing that says that you have to have a particular state of mind. Like, there are some laws that say if you do this knowingly or if you do it willfully or something like that. But a lot of laws just have absolutely no mens rea requirement whatsoever. So that does give a ton of flexibility on who will be prosecuted and who won't.
So we have a problem with prosecutorial discretion being necessary in many cases because there are too many laws. Another thing that happens as a result of that, I would argue, is giving the police a lot of discretion as to who they are going to arrest, who they are going to arrest in what way, and who they are going to let skate. Police abuse, Black Lives Matter. We have a burgeoning police state, it seems to me.
Yeah, definitely. And I think, with this kind of rising up of the Black Lives Matter movement, I think we are seeing that in a lot of ways kind of what has felt like the more traditional equation of the relationship between police and citizens has really changed. And people are understanding that there has been built into that system a lot of discretion and a lot of ability for abuse. And both sides are really viewing each other as the enemy now. I think that, really when you look at police, we give them a tremendous amount of power, potentially the power to kill someone.
What do you mean potentially?
Without any sort of a trial, without any sort of charging of a crime, without any of the sort of due process protections that our Constitution generally builds in for people who are accused of a crime. And I think, again, it's the situation where we know that power might be necessary. I think everyone understands that there may be times where a police might use force legitimately. And what we've got now is decades of almost no oversight, almost no self-regulation. If we are going to grant public servants that type of a power, to the extent that we have granted it to them, keeping a tight rein on that is just that much more important. And it's been clear for years, I think, to most people who've watched it, that police are killing people and,
you know, what's interesting,
never
to me,
charged.
What's interesting to me is that we used to hear stories about police abuse and we would discount them. And we would say it's criminals, you know, whining. And that was pretty much the refrain up until...
Just around cell phones.
Technology has started taking film, mm-hmm. started taking video of police doing what everybody said was just a phony complaint in the past. And I think we need to keep in mind that, you know, a lot of this is black on white, white on black, supposedly. But mm-hmm. there's an awful lot of police abuse against whites as well sure. as blacks. It is not... necessarily.
Some of the recent shootings were black on black, black officers killing black
yeah,
people.
I mean, it's not necessarily, in some cases it's a racial issue, but in many, many cases, probably the majority of cases, there's nothing racial about it. It's a power struggle, and the mm-hmm. power mm-hmm. that the police have or think they have is a power that's abused. And the really scary and the really unfortunate part is the police officers who are also on the scene and know that their comrade is guilty as hell don't mm-hmm. say anything. That's yeah. aiding and abetting, if I understand the law correctly.
Yeah, and you know, I think just to me, what's been disheartening, I think, kind of from a libertarian perspective, is that this was kind of a time period where I think a lot of libertarians would have had some sympathies towards Black Lives Matter movement, and there may have been a good opportunity to get some real reforms. I think it.
Raising legitimate right. concerns that need to be addressed, but their overall message, I think, is getting lost in the way that they're delivering.
You're talking about the Black Lives Matter movement.
Yeah,
itself.
And mm-hmm. we want to see reform. We want to see accountability. We want to see cameras on police. We want citizens to be able to film police abuses without having their camera phones taken and erased. And if they would have really focused on solutions instead of focusing on the racial issue, which
well, you've
is
got,
of,
you've got the Al Sharpton types moving in and using it for
sure.
publicity,
which is less of a concern, as you noted. There's just as many whites and Hispanics who are dying at the hands of police as
well. There's more in raw numbers, less yeah. as far
proportionally,
as
proportionally, yes, more yeah. African Americans, mm-hmm. But right, the bottom line is accountability, and I love what technology has afforded us, the ability for us as citizens to become active, to become involved. And there are people who make it their work, and their goal is to just go out and film police encounters on the off chance that it'll end badly, and they'll have an opportunity to provide the crucial evidence that otherwise, you know, prior to this, mm-hmm. cops were able to write the reports themselves, and whatever they said went.
And as I understand it... filming a public servant in the act of doing their job is completely legal.
100%.
100%.
No yeah. question.
So,
not that all cops know that, because
right.
many of them
many cops
believe,
will tell you otherwise.
The opposite view.
Well, that's a pretty simple thing to teach. All for all of the 2.5 policemen who are watching the show, you now know.
2.5 people, yeah.
2.5 people. They're both cops. They're writing this all down. My license number is, what's your license
yeah.
number?
No.
So I absolutely agree. When you give power corrupts, the greater mm-hmm. the amount of power, the greater the corruption. This is a lesson of history.
But the bottom line is we give police way too many laws to enforce.
No. Absolutely.
If we My cut goodness. Back on the number of laws, particularly drug laws, that's the biggest category, but there's a whole lot of others.
The best example is Eric Garner, who was
selling,
choked out and killed because he was selling Lucy cigarettes.
Yeah, one cigarette at a time.
Lucy?
In New York, they're called Lucy's.
Yeah.
Single cigarettes because cigarettes are so darn expensive in New York.
And they're expensive because of the tax on them. Marijuana is expensive because
it's illegal.
Of the tax. That is the tax.
Yeah,
it's a much higher tax.
The Libertarians on three more issues before we wrap things up and we can get through them. Education. What's the libertarian position on education, Johanna?
I can't remember who said it, but I heard the quote that school choice and the power of people to choose the education for their children is one of the greatest civil rights issues of this time period. And we're seeing a lot of really great reforms in a lot of states who are taking an active role in empowering parents to select educational choices that suit their children's needs instead of letting the state decide where their kids should go to school and how they should be educated. And the teacher unions hate it. The public school administrators hate it. But it's really changing the game for a lot of families.
So you're really saying education as opposed to indoctrination.
Yeah. Imagine that, right? That somebody can send their children to a school who won't, you know, teach them that the government is the best.
Well, there's another thing, quickly, accountability. Anybody who wants to improve any process or any project holds people accountable for results. And so I would say categorically that any organization or group of people who does not want to be held accountable for their productivity in creating an educated student basically does not want that process to go well for the student. I think we can categorically say that government schools, I don't want to call them public schools because they're government schools, mm-hmm. are there for the benefit of the ruling class, the teachers, the administrators, and all the rest of that. If you have any question about that, just look at the average pension for a government school teacher in the state of California. And then look at what the chances of their students earning that in any livelihood they're going to go to is. Kind of an awkward sentence, but that kind of spells it out.
But the great thing about school choice programs is they not only give better opportunities at these private schools, but they also help to improve the government schools as well, because all of a sudden, competition is introduced into these systems.
Oh, good. Competition.
Imagine
competition is actually helpful.
Right.
It makes even public schools better.
Government schools.
Have been studies to show that school choice programs have actually boosted performance in government schools.
And the legal issue as far as school choice, where is that? I mean, I know that public school administrators, teachers unions, and so forth attack school choice at every opportunity. Is that a legal argument or a legal battle that will ultimately be won by the folks in favor of choice?
It appears to be the case. One of the biggest challenges is based on establishment clause, which is a prohibition against too much government entanglement with religion, and those arguments have not been successful.
And there's a lot of public private schools that are not religious anyway.
Precisely.
That's the show for this week. We'll see you again next week, same time, same place on the Libertarian Counterpoint. Thank you very much for being part of the show on YouTube, on accesssacramento.org.
Thank you, Richard.